Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alam. Sorry, I'm late because you see the time of the Maghrib now getting a little bit late. Maybe we think for next week to start at 7:40 maybe, if you think it will be okay, or 7:45. You see, because the Maghrib. Okay, so maybe next week we make it 7:45, so we have a time after the Salah. And beside, you know, I'm trying to arrange many things here. Anyway. طيب الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. إن شاء الله today we'll try to start volume number 2, the second volume of the explanation of Sheikh بن عثيمين, may Allah عز وجل have mercy on him, which is about Salah. Today, my dear brothers, you know, the hadith that we are going to explain and discuss, it may take us, more than one meeting to explain it, because it is really one of the most important hadith. There are many benefits, many lessons, and this hadith is very famous, very famous. You know, there are certain hadith which was labeled, it's like a nickname, it was labeled and became famous among ulama, among students of knowledge. Like, for example, when you say Hadith Jibril, Hadith Jibril, this is one hadith, you know, which talk about the foundation of Islam and the pillars of Islam and the articles of faith. And it's been very famous among ulama, among people, because this talk about when the Jibril alayhi salam, he came, you know, and in the form of man. And then he met the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam in front of the Sahaba. All the Sahaba, they saw this strange man for them who sat in front of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and asked many questions. This hadith was, you know, known as Hadith Jibril al-Mashhur. Always you'll find the book, the famous hadith of Jibril alayhi salam. Today, another hadith which is famous also among ulama with another label. They call it Hadith al-Musi'u fi Salatih. Hadith al-Musi fi Salati. The hadith of the one, you know, who pray badly, or he doesn't perform his prayers in the perfect way. Hadith al-Musi fi Salati. And we'll talk about this in detail. Just I would like to mention, you know, in our book that we are studying, the book of Bulugh al-Maram, the Sheikh did not report or wrote the whole hadith. So it's just started by, you know, explaining how to perform what the Prophet ﷺ said about performing Salah. So maybe you notice that he started by saying, إِذَا أَرَدْتَ الْقِيَامِ بِالصَّلَاةِ, whenever you want to stand for prayer, first of all, perform wudu. And then it's continue. But in fact, there's one part, or the first part of the hadith was not mentioned in this book. So what I did today, I posted this hadith in the lesson in my Facebook page along with the video. So those brothers who are with me now on Zoom live may not see this because they are with me, you know, we are interacting here. So maybe you can check later and see the whole hadith. It is already posted in Facebook. So let's start with this hadith. I just want to connect the also here the mic for the so it will be clear. Yeah, bismillah, just a minute. Yeah. So let's explain the hadith as it was explained by Sheikh bin Uthaymeen. We'll go one by one according to what he said. Now he started with, the Sheikh started with saying Bab Sifat al-Salah. So he gave it this title, Bab Sifat al-Salah, chapter on the description of Salah. That means description, or how to pray, or what's the right way to pray. So this here we talking about
the way to perform a salah according to the teaching of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Let me just try to this, put this here because I want the mic here is not clear. And then he started with explaining what does this mean when you talk about description about or description of salah. So he said, أي أهميتها هيئتها القولية والفعلية, which means how to pray salah in terms of actions and in terms of saying or what to say in the salah. So here, when the hadith talk about description of the salah or how to pray, and when we talk about sifat al-salah, how to pray, that mean what we, how we do it, how we act, how we move how from one position to another, what is the exact way to perform every and each position, and what are the words that we say in every position. So, two parts. Start talking about actions in salah and saying in salah. This combine hay'at al-salah or the way to perform salah. And this is the way, as the Sheikh said, always this bab or this chapter, always you find it in the books of fiqh when we talk about ibadat, when we talk about any acts of worship. Therefore, you will find the books of the ulama, sifat al-hajj, sifat al-siyam, you know, talk special chapter how to perform hajj, special chapter describe how we do this salah, I mean this siyam. There is one brother, I think he have his mic on, so he's making some noise. So please, brother Abdul Majid, I would like you always to check and make sure that all are mute, so we will not disturb us. Jazakallah khair. We'll open mics for those people, brothers, after we finish at the end of the class. And the brother Abdul Majid, he's the admin here, and he, jazakallah khair, he will make arrangement to give the chance to everyone to ask. So please, brothers, always put your mic on mute. طيب. So, and then the Sheikh started by pointing very important matter about any act of ibadah, any act of ibadah, or how, what is the condition, what are the conditions for any ibadah to be accepted. So he said, any ibadah, لا تصح إلا بشرطين. Any ibadah will not be accepted, will not be considered valid, except with two conditions. What are these conditions? First one, al-ikhlas lillah, sincerity. That means the person who is performing this ibadah, this salah, this siyam, this hajj, first of all, he should do it with the intention to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to do his duties toward Allah Azza wa Jal. So the intention, this is the first corner of the ibadah. The second one is following the example of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Al-mutaba'a li rasulillahi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Therefore, for any act of ibadah, these two conditions should exist. If one of them lost or was missed, that means this ibadah is not valid. Maybe a person do the ibadah perfectly, but the intention is not for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jal, just to show off for others. It will not be accepted. The salah or any the ibadah, it will not be valid. Or a person, maybe he will do it sincerely, but he doesn't do it in the right way. That means he doesn't know how to perform this ibadah. And the example here in this hadith that we are discussing today is about one sincere sahabi. He's one of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who came to pray, but when he start praying, there is some mistakes in his prayer. That means there is some shortage. This is why the ulama call it al-musif salat. He doesn't do it the right way. And the sheikh here, he has very nice comment. He said, this labeling, al-musif salat, that's not correct and should not be said. Because this person, in fact, his intention is to do it right, but what prevented him from doing the salah in the right way is not because he is an ignorant. That means he doesn't know how to do it. So he lack the knowledge of doing the ibadah, which means that he's not intentionally made this salah or did this salah or did this prayer in a bad way. It was not his intention. But because he is ignorant, he doesn't know, so he do it in the way that he thinks that it is correct. And this is very important, brothers. This hadith is very important, and we'll go point by point, because there's many lessons, as the Sheikh said here. So, sincerity, we know it. We discussed it many times. We said that the person should seek the pleasure of Allah Azza wa Jal, and the intention is in the heart. The intention is in the heart. That means no need to pronounce our intention. You know, to say, oh Allah, I want to pray for rak'ah. Oh Allah, I want to do this or that. Allah Azza wa Jal knows what you are going to do before even you plan to do it. So there's no way. Besides, this is not the way of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam or the Sahaba. The intention is the motive that was initiated in the heart. And you act according to this motivation, which is in your heart. So this is the meaning of intention. Intention is in the heart. Now, so the other part, which is our subject today, al-mutaba'a, how to follow the example of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when he pray. This we cannot take it just by, by our imagination. Or by even our good intention. No. This needs, knowledge. Which means, if I want to follow the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and do my prayers exactly, or at least following his example, then I should know, how did the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam perform his salah? The Prophet alayhi salatu wa sallam said, advised us and said, صلوا كما رأيتموني أصلي. Pray the same way as you seeing me praying. You see my prayer? Pray like me. For us, we don't see the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So how can we pray? Or following this hadith, if we didn't see the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but the Sahaba who prayed with the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam and prayed after him, they in fact transmitted to us in full details every tiny things about what the Prophet ﷺ is doing or performing, either in Hajj or in Salah or in any other subject or any other issues. So here we have the example, here the hadith which was reported, narrated by Abu Hurayrah radiallahu anhu. Now, what is the story of this hadith? The story of this hadith, that one man, he came to the Prophet ﷺ was sitting with the Sahaba in the masjid, and then a man came, entered the masjid. He knows that when he entered the masjid, he should offer two rak'ah, which is tahiyyat al-masjid. And this is what he did. So he prayed two rak'ah. And then after he finished his salah, he came to greet the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and sit with him, and he said, assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullah wa barakatuh. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam responded to his greeting, and he said, wa alaykum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. But then he followed it with what? By saying, irji' fasalli fa innaka lam tusall. Go back and pray, because he didn't pray. So the man, he went and he did the prayer again, the second time. He prayed at Waraka. And then he came to the Prophet ﷺ and greeted him again. And there's another lesson here. So the Prophet ﷺ responded to his greeting by saying, وَعَلَيْكُمْ السَّلَامُ. And then he said to him again, go back and pray because you didn't pray. And he did it for the third times. After the third times, he came and the Prophet ﷺ told him, go back and pray it. He said, وَالَّذِي بَعَثَكَ بِالْحَقِّ وَالَّذِي بَعَثَكَ بِالْحَقِّ لَا أَحْسِنُ غَيْرَ ذَلِكَ. By the one who sent you with the truth, I don't know better than what I did. And here, look, brothers, subhanAllah, here are many points that I would like to point out and think about it, because every word in this hadith has a deep meaning. First one, look at the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He was sitting in the masjid, but he noticed this man and he followed what he's doing. So he was able to give him some instruction, some advice. Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam is caring about all, everybody, to do their ibadah in the right way. Second, the person when he came, he greeted the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Now the question, how many times he said assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh? 3 times. That means every time he says assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and then he go back and he come shortly and say assalam. So from this we learn that repetition of the salam than more one than one time, it is okay and accepted and it is recommended. Some people now, if you sit with him and he went, for example, outside the room, and then he came back and said, assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullah. Some people, they get, you know, upset. They said, yeah, Sheikh, you are just with us and you just left. And you come back and every time, assalamu alaykum, assalamu alaykum. Subhanallah. This is because many people, they don't understand what does it mean, assalamu alaykum. As-salam is the name of Allah Azza wa Jal. And this is dua. That's may the peace of Allah and the mercy of Allah with you. Does anybody doesn't, you know, have any, you know, problem not to accepting or getting more of this dua? So the Sahaba, it's mentioned that the Sahaba sometimes they walk together, two Sahaba, two of the companions of the Prophet, and while they are walking, maybe there's only three separated them. So they come from both sides. When they meet, they say, assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. It's a greeting. So in this hadith, this man, he came 3 times. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam responded to his salam. He didn't say, why you say it every time, assalam, assalam, 3 times? No. This to teach us to say assalam always, even if somebody left for even a few minutes or less than that. So this is another lesson. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said to him, "Irji' fasalli fa innaka lam tusalli." Go back and pray because you didn't pray. Subhanallah. This man, he prayed in the masjid in front of him. So what is the meaning of you didn't pray? There is two meanings. Either that you didn't effort, you didn't do the prayer, you just enter the masjid and you come and sit with us. That means this is what we call it, the physical. Okay, this is the sense here. And this is not right because he's already did. He already standing and he prayed what he did. So why the Prophet ﷺ, he said to him, you didn't pray. The meaning here, that's you, it means you didn't pray the salah in the perfect and the correct way. So here talking about not the action, but how perfect is the action to be valid, to be considered as salah. Okay, why the Prophet did not teach him for the first time? Because, you know, the Prophet want him to try. So when he come and he give up and he said, this is what I know, this will be more effect on him. So he will be receive the teaching eagerly, you know, in more deep. He want to understand, pay more attention, because he want to learn something that he doesn't know. And this, my dear brother, sometimes you come to advise people and they don't accept the advice. Why? You tell him, brother, you know, your salah window. He said, yeah, you know. You give him the explanation and he look at you and smiling and you think, okay, I just, you know, I'm listening to you, but I know what you are saying. Because they didn't look at their action and they discovered by themselves that what they did was not correct or perfect. And this, my dear brothers, unfortunately, the case of many people, unfortunately, many Muslims. We are Muslim, alhamdulillah. Even people who grow here, I mean, in Mecca, Medina, or in this area, or everywhere. We grow up as Muslim, alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. This is grace from Allah Azza wa Jalla. Our parents, our family are Muslims, alhamdulillah. This is a blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But the problem with this, that people learn the ibadah in a way of imitation. What does it mean, imitation? Does it mean imitate what other people doing without studying, without learning, without thinking, without trying to check the salah of the person that they imitate him? Is it perfect? Is it correct or not? This is the problem. So if you advise anybody about something, especially about salah, he thinks that, what do you mean that I don't know how to pray? I've been praying, you know, with my father, with my teacher, you know, in my community, in our masjid for many years. And now you are telling me that there's a problem with my salah. But if you sit with him and ask him, how did you learn this prayer? Since he was young, mashallah, his very righteous parents advised him, commanded him, forced him maybe when he was young to pray. So he started to pray. And then the salah become as what? As a habit. Just action he do, but without deep meaning. And this is the problem when we imitate people without thinking. This Sahabi, he's one of the companions of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And he living with him. And look at him. He said, O Prophet of Allah, the third time, by the one who sent you the truth, I don't know better than what I did. This, he is a Sahabi, and he acknowledged that he doesn't know, you know, how to do the salah in a perfect way, as it was expected from the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam when he advised him and told him to go back and pray again. Subhanallah, if this is one of the Sahaba who lived with the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and he was maybe imitating the Prophet and the other companions, but without deep learning and understanding, and he had this shortage. So what we will say about ourselves, our people around us? This is a problem, serious problem, that when people, they just do their ibadah in a way of imitation without, you know, based it on true and deep knowledge of the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It's mentioned one story, I'm not sure about how authentic this story, but it said, maybe I can check this later, but it said that one man, he was doing the wudu. He was doing the wudu, and one of our salaf and sister, he saw him, and he said, oh man, you are not doing the wudu the right way, the correct way. Your wudu is not perfect, is not complete, is not valid in this way. Maybe he left part of the foot or anything that he didn't. And this man, he answered him, he said, I've been praying with this wudu for 60 years. 60 years of my life, I spend it praying after doing this wudu. And this alim, he told him what? He told him, for 60 years, you didn't pray. Subhanallah. Why? Because the wudu is a condition of for the salah. But we don't blame that man, because we know, and this is one of the lessons that we learned from here, that if the person doing something because of ignorance, that means he doesn't know, you know, to do it the right way, then he will not be blamed because he is excused because of his ignorance of the hukum or the ruling. So we're not blaming him. But you know, look at the point here. The point of a person who thought for 60 years that he's doing his prayer while this prayer was not valid because he doesn't know how to make wudu. And this, my dear brothers, you know, all of us, me and you, brothers who are listening, brother who are studying, brother of knowledge, students of knowledge, this is our task, to enlighten people around us, our family, our children, our neighbor, everybody that we know. Inform them, enlighten them how to do the ibad in the correct way. So people will not be questioned, because people are of two types. Some of them, they will not be excused. And some, they are excused. What's the difference between the two groups? The first one, who they have no excuse, Muslim or people who are living in a Muslim community or around Muslim people who have knowledge. So they have no excuse because they should ask. Because Allah Azza wa Jal said, فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. You should ask the people of knowledge if you but don't know. There are, or there is someone who doesn't know, but there is nobody is teaching him. I went across one of these situations, subhanAllah. In the US, there is one brother, he passed away, may Allah Azza wa Jal have mercy on him. He's an old man, his name is Abdul Sabur. May Allah yarhamuhu. He embraced Islam. He met someone who taught him about Islam, you know, the meaning of La ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah, and he accepted Islam. And he said, Ashhadu La ilaha illallah, Ashhadu Anna Muhammad Rasulullah. And then he was planning to meet with this person to teach him more, but that person disappeared. It seemed that he met him accidentally, or he traveled, or he left somewhere else. This brother told me that he stayed 10 years, and he doesn't know how to pray. And nobody taught him, and nobody around him as a Muslim. He doesn't know how to pray, or the Salah is part of the religion, which is must. After 10 years, he found somebody who taught him, and he started his Salah. And he was very sorry. He felt very guilty. I told him, brother, don't be guilty. As long as nobody knows around you, inshallah, you will not be questioned about this 10 years. May Allah forgive you. But the point what I'm saying here, there are some people who are far away. You know, nobody is teaching them. May Allah Azza wa Jal forgive them. But people around us, it is our duty to teach them. So in this hadith, this sahabi, when he came to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and he said, O Prophet of Allah, he said, by the one who sent you with the truth. And this is very nice, you know, form of swearing. He didn't say, Wallahi, I don't know how to do it. By Allah, I don't know how to do it. He said, he chose the right words. He said, by the one who sent you with the truth, I don't know better than what I did. Which means, Allah Azza wa Jal sent you with the truth, and I will take this truth to learn the truth, to learn the correct way from you, O Prophet of Allah. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam started teaching him, which is all these points that we are going to discuss it in this hadith. So, here, as you know, you notice here, we learn some points from the hadith, which is very, very important. And this, as we said at the beginning, this was not mentioned in the book of Bulugh al-Maram, because it started with explaining the way of performing the salah. Now, and then let's go now to some points which is relate to this hadith. When he said, وَالَّذِي بَعْثَكَ بِالْحَقِّ. And then he said, He said, عَلِّمْنِي. In his way, عَلِّمْنِي. O Prophet of Allah, teach me how to pray. And then the Prophet started teaching him how to pray. And this is what the hadith was. It started from here in our book, بلوغ المرء. قال إذا قمت إلى الصلاة فأسبغ الوضوء. When you stand, the word قام or قمت, that means when you stand up for prayer, فأسبغ الوضوء. When you stand in prayer, then you should have perfect وضوء. Perfect وضوء. That means when you stand here, it doesn't mean when you stand in front of the Qibla. No, that means when you start the process of performing your prayer, the first thing before you start the Salah, first of all, you should have or you should perform perfect wudu. Asbigh al-wudu. Asbigh al-wudu. That means here, we learn that al-wudu or purification, what they call it, ablution here, is what? A conditions, one of the conditions of the salah. Now, what do we mean by condition? I know that maybe you get boring from me repeating this many times. What the difference between the condition, al-shart, wal-wajib, wal-rukun? The conditions are what is what they call it, prerequisite or required before we start the ibadah. It should be there. Like, for example, al-wudu. Performing wudu should be there before we start the salah. Nobody can start the salah and then he said, you know, after I start the salah, then I'll make the wudu. That's not right. Before you enter and stand to say Allahu Akbar, you should have perfect wudu. Now, and then al-wudu, as you know, this is not our subject. And then what he said to him, so the wudu here we learn is what is one of the conditions. That means anyone who doesn't have wudu, he cannot pray. And this we already discussed it in detail when we talked about الطهارة. And then he said, ثم استقبل القبلة. And then face the قبلة. This is another condition which should be there before we start الصلاة. You cannot start the صلاة while you are facing one direction far from the قبلة, and then you remember and then you turn. And here maybe another point, maybe you can explain here. Is it possible sometimes that we face one direction and then we turn to the right direction? There's only in one situation. This when you are in a place and you don't know the right direction of the Qibla, and you ask before you start, you should ask. You asked and you investigate, you search, you try to find someone to tell you where is the right direction of the Qibla, and you didn't find any answer. Nobody helped you at that minute. And then you just imagine try to make the best guess for where is the correct direction of the Qibla, and then you start. And after you started your Salah, you did maybe the first Rak'ah, and then somebody came, maybe a person that you are visiting at his home, he came later, and he saw you praying to the wrong direction. So he give you, you know, he turn you maybe toward the right direction of the Qibla. Or he said to you, turn right or turn left to the right direction of the Qibla. Then you can turn and your salah is correct. You don't need to resume it from the beginning. No problem with this. But if the person knows the Qibla from the beginning, then he cannot start the salah before he is facing the Qibla. And remember, as we said, this is condition. Facing the Qibla is one of the conditions of the validity of the salah. Which means, if the person say takbir facing the Qibla, and during the salah, in any point, he moved left or right, turned away with his body, the whole body, from the direction of the Qibla, that means his salah is invalid. And he have to resume it from the beginning. Restart it again. The body. But if the face, remember we talk about this, if he's just turning with his face left or right very quickly, this will not invalidate his salah. He can continue. But if the person who do all this the whole time, looking right and left for sure, this will invalidate his salah. Because this is excessive, unnecessary movement. But you hear voice and look very quickly, or something attract your attention and you turn with your face, this will not invalidate the salah. You can continue, no problem. But if somebody turned away with the whole body, that means his salah is invalid and he should restart it again. And then he said, takbeer. Okay, now this is the instruction of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Face the Qibla, فَكَبِّرْ ثُمَّ اسْتَقْبِلَ الْقِبْلَ. Then, after having wudu, then, استقبل القبلة. Face the Qibla, فَكَبِّرْ. What does it mean? When you stand and you are in a position facing the Qibla, say, Allahu Akbar. Look, the word فَكَبِّرْ. That means to say, exactly these two words. Allahu Akbar. Why? Because this is the meaning of saying kabbir. This is the meaning of takbir. But if somebody say another word, like said, Allah the greatest, we say this is not valid. But it has the meaning. Yes, it has. But takbir, you should say the word of takbir. Allahu Akbar. If somebody say, Allahu al-Ali, by Allah the Most High, this is not valid. Why? Because the Prophet ﷺ said, takbir. Even if he changed the order of the words, instead of saying, Allahu Akbar, said, Akbarun huwa Allah. Akbar, Allah. Instead of saying, Allahu Akbar, Allah, Akbar, he said, Akbar is Allah, Allah. This change in this order of these words will not make it takbir. Because the takbir is to say what? The exact word, Allahu Akbar. So this is the right way according to this hadith. And then he said to him, now he started takbir, waqra. ثم اقرأ ما تيسر معك من القرآن. Then, after you say Allahu Akbar, recite whatever portions that you know of the Quran. You have. Whatever you know of the Quran. Whatever. ما تيسر معك. Even something which is very short or little of the Quran. اقرأ. Recite. اقرأ. Read. Read. And when it said iqra, that's mean movement of what? Of the lips and the tongue with every letter. This is al-qira'a. Not reading with eyes only. And here, my dear brothers, I would like to mention very important matter. Some people are ignorant. Maybe you find that some people are, you know, in the masjid or somewhere else. MashaAllah, he said, I, mashallah, finish the Qur'an every week. Mashallah, good. That's great. May Allah reward you. How you do it? He just put the mushaf in front of him and just scanning with his eyes, scanning the whole mushaf. That's not reading. Because the hadith which give the ajr is for reading, not for scanning, not just for looking. Reading. من قرأ حرف من كتاب الله, the one who read one letter of the Quran, he will be giving the reward of 10 times. And the Prophet ﷺ said, so the person, if he said only 3 letters, and this explained by the hadith, لا أقول ألف لام ميم حرف ولكن ألف حرف ولام حرف وميم حرف. I don't say ألف A, Lam, L, Mim, M, which is, you know, this is a short alphabet that you find it, for example, in Surah Al-Baqarah, at the beginning of Surah Al-Baqarah, Alif, Lam, Mim. I don't say these 3, one harf, but every single one of these 3 letters will be considered as letters, and for every each one, you will be get the reward of 10 times, which means you will give 30 Hasanat, just for saying these 3 3 letters. Subhanallah. So very important to understand. Read, Iqra. So the person who is in Salah, he should read, not reading silently without, you know, he doesn't move his lips or tongue, and he read in his only memory. And he said, Alhamdulillah, I finish Al-Fatiha, and then he make ruku'. That's meaning Salah is in Al-Balad. So according to this, he said, Iqra ma tayassar ma'ak. But the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, subhanallah, he didn't, you know, say to him, read dua al-istiftah. There are some supplications, we know, before we recite Al-Fatiha. The Prophet did not say this. He go directly to recite the Quran. Why? Because this person is need the basic now. Need the basic, which is required. That doesn't mean dua al-istiftah or this supplication that we start the salah with after saying Allahu Akbar and between the takbeer and reciting al-Fatiha is not important. It is important because it's the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And there's many forms of this dua. And we should learn it. And it's better to say it, to make our salah is perfect. But this person, this man, this companion, may Allah be pleased with him, he need to learn the basic now, and also to teach us, we learn from this hadith, what is required. Because supplication is not must, it's not wajib, it is sunnah. So the Prophet ﷺ, he want to tell him what are the things which is required for his salah to be perfect. And then the Prophet ﷺ told him to recite what you know of the Quran. Ma tayassar, whatever, even little, something that you know of the Quran. He didn't mention that you need to recite Surah Al-Fatiha. Some people, because of this hadith, they said from this hadith, we learn that Surah Al-Fatiha is not must. And this is a view, by the way, of some of the Hanafi, some, not all, of the Hanafi, they don't consider Surah or recitation, Surah Al-Fatiha, is Rukun. But all the other school of Fiqh, they consider it as Rukun. Why? Because of the Hadith of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, لا صلاة لمن لم يقرأ بفاتحة الكتاب. You see, this here Hadith that say to this man, recite whatever you have of the Quran. This is general. But there is more explanation in a specific way, which is mentioned in other ahadith, which is the hadith that said, now we know that we read the Quran, but then when we hear and we learn that there is another hadith from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, an authentic hadith that said, there is no salah for the one who doesn't read Surah Al-Fatiha, we learn that Surah Al-Fatiha is rukun. That means it's a pillar of the salah. And therefore, the person, he should recite and read Surah Al-Fatiha. But here he told him what is. From this hadith, maybe this person, he doesn't know much of, that, of the Quran. This is one. Also, this is a lesson for us, especially for brothers who are new in Islam. A person, a new Muslim, when he embraces Islam, he doesn't know Surah Al-Fatiha. He just embraces Islam. But the minute that he entered Islam or accepted Islam, he should start praying. And this is very important for the dua, for the da'iyah. Please, brothers, when you call somebody to Islam, invite somebody to Islam, teach somebody to become Muslim, the first thing, before you leave him alone, the first thing you should teach him after knowing the meaning of the shahada is how to perform tahara, purification, from major and minor, and how to perform the salah. At least the movement. We know that the recitation may take time. Takes time to, you know, to memorize, you know, Al-Fatiha, some of the Qur'an, to memorize some of the adhkar. But at least the movement. How to move? Show him an example. But he, now he knows how to do the salah, but he doesn't know what to say. You ask him, do you know how to say Alhamdulillah? Alhamdulillah. Okay, good. You can add Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. Always when I meet some of these our new brothers in Islam, especially those who are living in among us Muslim here, I ask him before I teach him, I said, كيف حالك in Arabic? Because they are automatically will answer Alhamdulillah. Yeah, they learn this, you know, because they are living among us. Then I said, aha, you see this word Alhamdulillah? Remember this word. So when you start the salah, just start by saying Alhamdulillah. And then you increase every day till you will be able to memorize the whole Al-Fatiha. So the person who doesn't know anything of the Quran, when he learns the salah, when he stands, he repeats whatever he knows of the dhikr. So he said Allahu Akbar, he said Alhamdulillah, Alhamdulillah. He repeats it as much as he wants. Subhanallah, whatever. Words, La ilaha illallah, that he know. But he should learn later on. So this Sahabi, the Prophet ﷺ, told him, say whatever you know of the Quran that you have. So we learn here that the standing position, Al-Qiyam, this is the position when the person should recite the Quran. Be careful. For every position in the salah, there is certain dhikr. And it's not for us to choose what to say. Not to us to say, well, why I don't recite the Quran while I'm prostrating or during the rukut? I said, no. Isn't the Quran is the best? Yes, the Quran is the best. But the position to recite the Quran while you are standing in salah, not while you are bowing, nor when you are in the prostration position. This is the following the teaching here. We don't, you know, innovate something from our mind to see this is good and or this is not. We just follow the example and the teaching of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I think the time is almost over, so I would like to leave some time for the questions. And inshallah, as I said, we'll spend some time with this hadith because there's many lessons to learn from this hadith. So, brother Ibn al-Majid, will you see if there's any of the brother you have any question? You can ask. Jazakum Allah khair, barakallahu feekum. Naam. Naam. وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله أهلا وسهلا ما شاء الله جزاك الله خير that's good suggestion إن شاء الله okay if everybody because now maybe the other Some people are scared of testing or questioning, but that's good an idea. Inshallah, maybe we'll start it next week. At the end of every class, I will raise two or three questions, inshallah, to see how much we learn. Jazakallah for this suggestion. Now, other questions? Now. Yes, Abu Khalid. Oh, Nabi Khan. Fadal. Alaykum as-salam, brother Nabi. Ahlan wa sahlan. Now. Yes. Now. Forget what? Saying Bismillah at the beginning of Surah Al-Fatiha. Now. طيب في سورة الفاتحة بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم there is different you know this debatable issue among ulama is it part of the Fatiha or it's not part of the Fatiha so those who said that بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم is one verse or one ayah of the Fatiha then the one should say it if he didn't say it that means he didn't recite in the whole Fatiha. This is for those who say that it is one of the seven verses of the Surah Al-Fatiha. The other view that said, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, this is introduction for all the surah, and it's not considered as verse of Surah Al-Fatiha. In fact, it is part of a verse in Surah An-Naml. Surah An-Naml. Innahu min Sulaiman. وأنه بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. That's there. It is considered as verse. But in سورة الفاتحة, it is not part. This is why now when we start, maybe you hear here especially when they start the salah, they don't say it and pronounce بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم loudly. Maybe say it silently. So in this case, for the person if he forgot to say this, then it will not be affecting. But if it is considered as verse. Then that means it's need to be said. Barakallah fi. Now. Yes, brother. Okay. Who is asking, brother? Sheikh Abdul Majid, who is the one who is asking? The voice is not clear for me. I didn't hear what the brother said. There's somebody, I think, he want to say something, but I didn't hear it. Did you hear the question? Can you say it to me? Yes. Yes.
Now, when a brother, a new Muslim, accepts Islam, yes. We teach him how to perform salah,
yes.
The actions, as you said. And then, Sheikh, what I do is I teach him, like, he can easily say Allahu Akbar, right? Yeah. When he starts the salah, right? Yeah. In each position, so he can say Allahu Akbar. Yeah. And then I tell him, because if he's praying alone in Dhuhr or Asr salah, I tell him the easy things like recite La ilaha illallah, say Alhamdulillah, Is it okay, Sheikh? Till he memorizes the Qur'an and the adhkar.
Yes. For and the standing position, okay, al-qiyam, he can repeat alhamdulillah, subhanallah. You see, it's better not to say Allahu Akbar here, because Allahu Akbar, just keep it. You will not confuse him, to make it when he moved from one position to another position. So he said, alhamdulillah, subhanallah. Now, when he go down, I mean for bowing, it's only two words. And I found from my experience for many new Muslim, it is very easy to be memorized, that even they write it down. To say subhanallah, just subhanallah, two words. Say it in the ruku', say it in the sujood. Till he, little bit, then we tell him, okay, add another word. Say, when you are bowing, say subhanallah, and then add another word, al-azim. In the prostration, say subhanallah, the same word that you said in ruku', but you add al-a'la. So it's okay, you know, to repeat all the adhkar while sitting, you know, while prostrating, any dhikr, and also in the standing position. And also beside, for new Muslim, maybe you can help him with to take like a card or write it down. I mean this for him, if he, when you go home and he to practice, and he can look and read it from paper, no problem. One brother from America was very smart, mashallah, and he was an old person. So he told me very nice way that he was able to learn this adhkar. He said, I post it in front of me in the wall at my room, and with very big, you know, writing. So he said, I look at the wall and try to recite and read from there. And this helped me to learn very quickly. So in conclusion, Jazakallah khair, Brother Muhyiddin, may Allah Azza wa Jal accept your effort in da'wah. But also we can do whatever he can memorize. Na'am, Jazakallah
khair. Jazakallah khair, thank you for clarifying that, Shaykh. Yeah.
Barakallah. Na'am. Na'am. Brothers, Abdul Hamid. Na'am. Sheikh Abdul Majid, is there any question, or we conclude our class?
Yeah, we'll conclude, Sheikh.
طيب, جزاكم الله خير.
We'll conclude, that's all, inshallah.
بارك الله فيكم. At the end of the class, we make dua that may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increase us all in knowledge, inshallah. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala get the whole ummah, you know, from this virus, the coronavirus, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us and save all Muslims and the whole world from this crisis. And we will be able, inshallah, to go back to our masajid and to pray safely, inshallah. But also here, I would like to say the last word, advise myself, remind myself, and remind all my brothers you know, and sisters who are following us. Every one of us have responsibility to follow the guideline and the instruction which is come from the Ministry of Health and the authority. We should follow it. In fact, this is a religious task. This is a religious must, wajib, that we should apply whatever the authority tell us to keep ourselves, to keep our, you know, our family, to keep our community from the spread of this virus. So please try to follow it, you know, and the dua. Don't forget adhkar al-sabah wal-masa. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us. Jazakum Allah khair. See you, inshallah, next week, next Sunday at 7:45, inshallah, p.m. Barakallah feekum. Wassalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaykum as-salam.
Jazakallah khair,
Shaykh. Wa iyaakum fi aman.